This is a joint work with a group of Professor Matthias Hollig in the University of Darmstadt. So today I show that we can teach smartphones to do very unusual things, and especially we can teach them to behave like a sort of software-defined radio. So I start by showing that, that a smartphone can think really different, and they can transmit raw signals that are crafted by users as they would do with the software-defined radio by simply designing the IQ samples. Then we move to channel state information extraction, and then I demonstrate how we can use these unusual things to deploy a covert channel. Okay, so we spent the last 10 years in doing a lot of reverse engineering of a very specific family of a chipset that was manufactured by Broadcom, and is very common because it powers millions of laptops and billions of mobile phones, especially the ones with Android. So we released a couple of projects in the past, in 2010, OpenFWWF project, and then more recently, the Nexmon project patching. So the most important findings today is that we, in the end, determined that there is a crossbar at a very low level of the radio that can be used to connect the radio, usually for streaming packets that are OFDM or DSS. But this crossbar can be connected to the memory, to an internal memory where you can store IQ samples. So you can design your signals and then they can be transmitted. So if you want to design a sinusoidal wave, it will be transmitted. So can smartphone think different? And the answer is yes, thanks to this crossbar. Okay, so how can this work, first of all, transmit raw signals? That's very easy, because you can store these IQ samples into the memory, and then you can start transmitting by simply flipping a bit in one register. Of course, you have to evaluate how good are these signals. So we started by transmitting sinusoidal waves, capturing with an oscilloscope, and they were correctly shaped with the right period, etc. Then we moved to a most challenging task, that is design 802.11 packets, but doing the real encoding, like OFDM or DSS. Then we transmitted this packet and we compared what happens at a specific receiver when you instead transmit real packets. And there is no statistical difference. So basically, this is really a software-defined radio platform. Regarding channel state information, this feature is pretty well known, and it's more or less supported by some chipsets. I remember here Intel with this CSI extraction tool on the 5300 chipset. This was used by some tools in the past, OnTracker Spot5 for the localization. The same was done for QCA Atheros chipset with the Cupid tool for localization. So for the Broadcom chipset, nobody demonstrated that it was possible to extract channel state information. And we were the first to understand that it was indeed possible also on very old 11G cards, which officially do not support the channel state information extraction. So this works in this way. There is the radio where the packets are received. We can wait until the packet is completely received, and then we can start fetching the channel state information from tables that are defined into the memory of this real-time CPU that is embedded on all Broadcom cards. Well, you have to pay attention, because if you do this before the packet is completely received, you stop the reception and then the packet cannot be decoded, but at least you can determine the channel state information. So basically what we did was to wait for the entire packet reception, and then we can push the channel state information together with the packet by calling multiple DMA transfer. So how can we determine that this feature really extracts the channel state information, because there are no official documents by Broadcom? So we started by doing some experiments using a narrow band interference and sweeping the carrier frequency of the interferer. And then by extracting over the time the channel state information, it turned out that there is an experimental match between the frequency of the interference and what we see in the evolution, on the time evolution of the channel state information. Then we moved, repeating some experiments that are used by other tools for localization. Basically, what we did was to use a version of the chipset that exposed antenna connectors. So, of course, this was not on a mobile phone, but this was required because we wanted to emulate the multipath. So here we are having a splitter, then we have two different paths of different lengths, and then a mixer, and here a receiver. Then we capture the channel state information and we apply a music algorithm that was demonstrated can determine the distance between the two paths. And by changing the length of the longest path, we determine that, actually this is channel state information because we perfectly see the two peaks with the expected distance between them. This is what you can get with a resolution of 20 megahertz. That is the minimum distance between the two peaks is approximately 20 meters. If we switch to 80 megahertz by using mobile phones with the newest 11AC chipset, of course, this distance decreases. So this tool can be also useful for localization purposes. Then finally, with the mobile phones, we did this final experiment by using 80 megahertz channel in the 5 gigahertz band. We put one mobile phone inside the microwave oven and another tool on the kitchen countertop of one of our authors. And then we started transmitting UDP packets in a ping-pong fashion between the two devices and extracting channel state information on the two of them. Then this is what we observed. Here we are opening the microwave, we are closing the lid, opening it again and again and again. And you see there is a very repeatable pattern in the channel state information, and this also demonstrates the symmetricity of the channel because this was the device inside, this was the device outside, this zigzag pattern can be observed on both of them. Okay, now, we would like to understand how to deploy a covered channel, but wait a moment. Before doing this, we have to make sure that we can really claim that we can make a software-defined radio out of a smartphone, because it's a very big claim. Well, there are some limitations, of course. So we started by measuring this limitation. But before showing the limitation, we have to better understand how this chipset works. So this is the radio. The radio has, the digital to analog and analog to digital converters. There is the crossbar. There is the memory, some circuitry for pre-shape packets. And then we have the real-time CPU. Then, on these chipset that power mobile phones, there is a microcontroller based on an ARM R4 CPU, and then this interfaces to the real mobile phone cores that runs the operating system and the application of the users. So this is a typical full mask chipset where the entire managing of the 802.11 protocols is performed by this separate ARM core. So first of all, what about the throughput between the ARM cores and the memory that can handle the IQ samples? Well, for a 20 megahertz channel, you need 40 mega sample per second. So this is very small compared to the what we measured, that for writing is only 53, and for reading, 25. So it's very, there is a very big difference, and so it's not sustainable. Of course, you can use the internal memory to store pre-shape packets, and this is what we actually did with our deployment of the cover channel. So we also determined there are other limitations, like the latency between when you receive something and the moment in time you can really craft the IQ samples. So there are limitations, so especially in this case, the tunability of the carrier is almost limited because it works only in the bandwidth that are for 802.11 protocol. Okay, there are limitations. We can, of course, use some of the tricks like collecting the channel state information instead of doing a real reception to make this faster. And now I show how we did for deploying a covered channel. The covered channel where you want to transmit packets between Alice and Bob without Eve being able to understand what's going on. So in our idea, what we did was to craft acknowledgement packet that Alice is sending to an access point when receiving a frame, so that the information inside this acknowledgement can be received by Bob. And in this case, instead of transmitting a real acknowledgement, what we do is to first compute the IQ coefficient for an acknowledgement, but then before transmitting, we simply convolve them by a fake channel response that where we really encode the embedded covered symbol. Then we transmit this sequence of symbols, and then at the receiver, what they do is, in standard 802.11 receiver, to equalize the reception. Of course, the equalization will remove the fake channel state, the fake channel response that we use for generating the samples, but Bob knows this, and so Bob is extracting the channel state information for getting back the covert message that we transmitted. So, performance. We tried to transmit covert byte. Well, this is a long story, but in any case, we can break bytes into multiple covert messages. And it turned out that out of 10,000 transmissions, we were able to receive almost 80% of them in very different situations, like in line of sight, non-line of sight, when the the smartphone inside the microwave. So this was successful. Regarding this 20% losses, we can think about having upper layers that can recover the wrong covert messages. So, concluding, we were able to really thought something different to smartphones, that is, you can work almost like a software-defined radio with some limits. What about other platforms? This was really interesting to see that Raspberry Pi 3 Plus have a very similar chipset, so you can do this experiment with a very cheap platform. And the roadmap for our work is to demonstrate cross-technology communication between mobile phones and other kind of communication protocol like ZigBee that is not really supported on mobile phones, and to try to transmit custom waveforms instead of standard packets to improve the accuracy of localization. For those that are interested about this work, there is this PhD thesis that was written by Matthias Schutz for his PhD title, recently obtained, about all what that was developed during the latest years. And with this, I have finished. And